Men's fellowship in park, and if it is you were in Stoila and fast by Mapring, and they will in the volleyball spiel. And they check your financial, you are in as new in August, so all the boards and committees for that they were in your free time, your claim forms, and bring your reports right me on. So the church's financial year is end of August, August 31st. So please, if you have any claim forms that need to be claimed, please bring them in, and also to start working on your reports for the annual meeting. The deadline is for the reports is September 6. And here's noch ein announcement, dort sagt the German Outreach Bible Study, dort wird Pastor Henry in Kleinstütze wieder mit Maya von reden. As to earning what Maya, what do a field begon to me, or what nicht erst in Bulletin an you come? An ich, an younger me, what forging to lesen. I wanted to read some verses from Luke. Luke chapter 15, from 1 to 7. And this is the parable about the lost sheep. And I saw a picture this last week with one single little lamb, very dirty. And that just caught my eye, and I wanted to read this verse for that. And I'm going to read it in German. Lukas Kapitel 15. And wenn ihr dort lesen, ich sah ein Bild von einem kleinen Lohm, ein Schweinchen. Und dort weiß ich bloß, dass Gott, der kriegt seine Finger und der hat die Hänger ran. Ich werde hier ein Plottisch lesen. Lukas Kapitel 15 von 1 bis 7. Dann brachten alle Tagskollekter in Sinn, dass sie nur an Jesus am zu hören. Aber die Schriftgelehrte und die Pharisäer grumsäugten durch Eva und sehen, des Mohn nimmt die Sünder an und atmet ihren Taub. Durab seht hei zu ihren dit Gleichnis. Wer von jünd, wann hei 100 Schub hat und ein von dir verlor, wo da nicht den jenen jenig auf den Stab luten und er dort verlorene Segen, bat hei dort Funk. Und wenn er dort fängt, leicht er sich dort mit Frieden auf den Schultern. Und wenn er dort mit dem Haus kommt, raubt er sich seine Freund in den Staub und sagt ihr, Fried jünd mit mir, willst ich haben ihn verlorenen Schub gefunden. Ich sage jünd, Gerud, so wollen sich auch die Engel im Himmel mehr über die Sünder freuen, die umgeht als über die 99 Rechte, die nicht am Kirchen brücken. Ich werde bloß abholen, weil Jesus über ein Schub, ein Lohm in den Engeln sich alle freuen, wenn dort zum Glauben kommt. Und weil wir auch freuen dürfen, wenn du fresh somebody in dem Haar gekommen ist. Aber einmal beten vorher wieder. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this beautiful morning. Thank you that we could come together as a family of believers and worship you. Thank you for giving us the health to come to church. And as we want to have a meet as a family, I pray that you'll just fill each individual, fill this place with your presence, that we can worship and praise you this morning. I pray for those that are sick, that can't be here. I pray that you'll just put your hand of healing on them. Let them feel your presence. Heal them so that they can get back up and on their feet. I pray for the other churches that are gathering this morning, especially those that are here in Belize, that are a part of our conference. I pray that you'll just be with them. Help us so that we can bring your light to the nation. Lord, I just want to thank you again for this morning. And as we go from here, as we continue this service, I pray that you will just bless us. For this in your name. Amen. Worship team.
Good morning. We're looking forward to singing some songs with you. I want to read Psalm 105, verse 1 to 5 before we start. Give praise to the Lord. Proclaim his name. Make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him. Sing praise to him. Tell of all his wonderful acts. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength. Seek his face always. And then remember the wonders he has done. his miracles and the judgment he has pronounced. It is our desire to sing together of what he has done and who he is this morning, and may it encourage us as we go out into the week to proclaim his name to the nations. We're going to start with a song, Thanks and Praise. If you feel like standing up, feel free to stand up and let's sing.
Thank you.
Wherever it is suitable for you to stand, we ask that you please stand for the next few. If it doesn't work for you, no problem. I've got a river of life. Us freely, and he wants to give us more.
Light of the world, shine upon us, set us
You may be seated.
Thank you, worship team, for leading us in worship. I'll ask the ushers if they want to get ready to do the offering. And let's bow before we take the offering. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you again for letting us come together here today morning. Lord, I thank you for giving us a good work week. And Lord, as we give back to you, I pray that it'll be used to widen your kingdom and that we can be blessed through that. Pray this in your name. Amen. Thank you for your gifts. Thank you for playing. Pastor Henry, will you serve us with your message?
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Good morning. I will speak a couple of words in German, and then I will go back to English. Announcements, what hier in Bulletin ist, wegen der German Outreach Bible Study, dort wird September den 12. Dienstaganfang hier in der Kirche. Und das ist für irgendwem, wer du so mal von der Kolonien, von Shipyard, Indian Creek, Little Belize, als hier haben getroffen, für jeden, das ist ein Outreach-Programm. Das, wenn ihr hier so alt seid, 20 Jahre mehr hier warst, dann nehme ich an, dass jeder auch selbst übertreten andere Menschen. So, das ist nicht unbedingt für jüng, das ist für so eine, was du so nie sein, was du so nie sein, aber doch auch kann viele Jahre sein, hier hier warst vielleicht. Das ist alles für so eine, was du so struggle wegen Englisch verstehen, für die Plan wie in der Digit-Programm daran hier so. Ich wollte dort anladen. So, ich will jetzt anladen. Kommt rüt für dort, das wird an der Dienstag sein. Ich plan den 12. September, plan ich anzufangen mit dort. Und ich kann wirklich Freunde anladen, wenn ihr wem weiten, wer diese mache, hier in dieser Kolonie wohnt, wo wem dort fehlen, das lädt ihr an, zum rüt kommt für dort. So. Und diese Werk, wir waren bei der Wiedergehen in dort Burg von Jakobus. Letztes Mal, wo ich davon reden, dort wird in Juli den Saas tienden, dort sind ja all even in Monat 3. Und so bloß um uns zu erinnern, was wir von Reden deuten da, wo ich das hier Karten mit übergehen, wo wir sehen, was wir auch von ihr reden haben. So erstens, Jakobus, da ist ein Buch, was wir kennen, das redet von Worten und auch von Glauben. Worten und Faith, Glauben, ja. Yeah. So dass der Schreiber von dort, das ist Jakobus, das wird ein Hofbruder von Jesus und er wird auch ein Lehrer in der Jerusalemische Kirche. So, wir fangen an, das erste Kapitel, Vers 1, die erste Sinne rede ich, und der Kapitel 1, der erste Hall von dem Kapitel, und dort handelt sich von, ob er Probe gestaltet worden, und ob er geduldig zu sein, persevere, like, du an geduldig sein, und du dadurch lehrt, wie stark zu sein in Christus. Und dann, der zweite Sinne, dann rede ich von, der zweite Hall, der letzte Part von Kapitel 1, dort handelt sich von Hirn und Daumen. Der 22. Vers, erste Kapitel, dort sagt, dort nicht bloß nur das Wort Hirn und Jüns selbst hinter Licht führen, aber dort wird das Wort sein. Dat. So, und von der, wo wir wieder durchgehen in Kapitel 2, und von der redet dort von, weil wir nicht Favorites haben. Jesus Christus hat nicht Favorites, und wir sollen nur nicht Favorites haben. Wo das sich von handeln, dort, dort fängt an in die erste Phase, dort redet von Rücke und arme Menschen. Und dort redet von, wo die, wenn die Menschen in ihre Versammlung nankommen, an der Rücke nankommen, dann auch ein armer Mann nankommen, dann wir sollen nicht in den Rücken sein, oh, du kommst, sagt hier, so auf eine Gaude steht in der Arme, oh, du stehst da und sagt, du auf der Flur. Das handelt sich von, dass sage ich, Gott hat nicht Favorites. Und wenn wir Favorites wiesen, dann, bloß wegen, wo die Menschen sich ungetrocknet sind, vielleicht oder was immer, dann bricht wieder das Gesatz. Jetzt wieder nennen, redet von, wo, wenn wir wollen, das helle Gesatz holen, läuft die Nube so aus die Salz. Und wir dann aber Favorites haben, dann bricht wieder das Gesatz. Und das redet von, wenn wir ein Gesatz brechen, dann bricht wieder alle Gesatzen. So, dort war das der Käse von Hornel und Dad. Today we continue in our series in the book of James. It's been a while since we've spoken on it. Last I spoke was July 16th, so that's over a month back already. Time sure does get by quick. So just to refresh our memories a little bit about what we've talked about this far, is the book of James is known for its teaching on both faith and works. So, and the book of James is believed to be the earliest book that was written in the New Testament. And the author is James, a half-brother of Jesus Christ. And he was also a leader, a pastor in the Jerusalem church, in the early church in Jerusalem. And that church faced many trials. A lot of persecution was happening there. So James wasn't just standing off on a distance and seeing how they were being persecuted. He was one of them that was being persecuted. So he knew what he was writing about, and he had an important message for the early church, and that message is just as important for us today. First half of the chapter talked about testing and persevering, how when we are tested, that through various trials, hardship, and suffering and whatnot, that produces in us a steadfast spirit of perseverance. And we ended, the second Sunday, we ended chapter 1 with where James teaches on hearing and doing the Word of God. He didn't have a whole lot of patience for people that just heard the Word of God. He said, if you hear the Word of God, you need to do the Word of God. The second, 22nd verse in chapter 1 says, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourself. Do what it says. So, and that's where we ended chapter 1, and today we jump into chapter 2. So, but before we go any further, let's bow our head for a word of prayer. Holy God, we come before you this morning, and Lord, we thank you that you are with us today. Your Spirit is with us. You are present with us this morning, and we thank you for that. And Father, we ask that you would have your way here this morning. Father, I pray that you would help myself, that I would be relaxed. Father, I feel anxious this morning, and I pray against the spirit of anxiety. And I pray that the Spirit of peace may be with us here this morning. And Father, I pray that you would be with each one. May we hear from your word. May your Spirit speak to us this morning. And Lord, I pray that you would be glorified through that. Father, I pray for those that can't be here because of sicknesses, and they would gladly be here, but they can't because they are not feeling well. Lord, I pray for them. I pray that you would, that your hand of healing would be upon them. And Father, I pray for those that are with us here this morning and those that are watching online. Lord, I pray for each one that we would open our spiritual eyes, our spiritual ears to hear from you, Lord. So, Father, I thank you that we have your word, we have your Spirit, and Lord, I just thank you and I praise you in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. My wife sometimes tells me, man, you were really sped up this morning, and I catch myself sometimes that when I start, I am very anxious, I speak very fast, and and the Holy Spirit just reminded me that the spirit of anxiousness wants to very often overtake me, and then I just rumble through stuff, and then later on when I sit down, I think it through a little bit, and I realize that, man, I didn't say what I wanted to say sometimes. So I don't know why I feel anxious, but I prayed against it, and I trust that the Spirit will come through. So this morning, we want to continue in the book of James in chapter 2. And James is speaking to us, and we are seeking to become more faithful Christians, right? Everyone here has a desire to be a faithful follower of a Christ, right? Or is there anyone here that says, no, I don't want to be a follower of Christ? I don't think you'd come to church if you didn't want to be a follower of Christ. So this morning, we trust that we will learn out of the book of James. So if you have your Bibles with you, gladly open it up to James chapter 2. I will also have the verses on here. I'll have them in English and in German, and the English one is out of the New NIV, and the German is out of the Bible. So let's read from 1 through 4. It says, my brothers and sisters, believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ must not show favoritism. Suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in filthy old clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing fine clothes and say, here's a good seat for you, but say to the poor man, you stand there or sit on the floor by my feet. Have you not discriminated among yourselves and became judges with evil thoughts? This far, for now. So what is James getting at here? What is he talking about? Now he's pretty clear. He's pretty direct to the point here. But one of the things that I just want to remind us of very often when we think of the Old Testament temple, the Jewish temple, we have all kinds of assumptions that weren't really there. Now, in our church, he's speaking of like when he comes into your meeting. So that means that when he comes into the temple court where they're meeting to worship. So in our church, we have pews, we have chairs. There's a lot of seating here. In the temple, to my understanding, in the inner court, they didn't have any seating there. The priests, they were working hard there. They were making all kinds of sacrifices. They were working there. And now, in the inner court, that's where that happened. But then they had the part where they were perhaps worshiping more. And there was some seating. There wasn't a whole lot of, it wasn't set full of benches the way we have it here. But there were some chairs there with footstools. And they were perhaps more to the front there, more to where they were worshiping more. Like these were special seats. Now what James is saying, now if a man comes in wearing a gold ring or with fine clothes, If he comes in and then also a poor man comes in and you say to the rich man, you see to the man, say to the man that is dressed well, you come and sit here on this chair here. We will give you a footstool. It's kind of like if someone comes over to your house and you invite him into a living room and he gets to sit where dad sits. This is the seat of honor. This is this chair has a footrest. You can put it up and you say you can sit there. But a poor person comes over and you say, well, no, you can stand off in a distance, or you can sit on the floor. He says, if you do that, have you not already made a judgment about that person? Have you not already, have evil thoughts not already come into your mind and you say, no, you're not worthy of the seat of honor. You can sit on the floor. So let's read a little bit further. From verse 5, I'll read all the way through 13. It says like this. Listen, my dear brothers and sisters. Has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be the rich, to be rich in faith, and to inherit the kingdom he promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. It is not the rich who are, is it not the rich who are exploiting you? Are they not the ones who are dragging you into court? Are they not the ones who are blaspheming the noble name of him to whom you belong? If you really keep the royal law found in Scripture, love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing right. Let me start again. If you really keep the royal law found in Scripture, love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing right. But if you show favoritism, you sin and are convicted by the law as lawbreakers. For whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of it. For he who said, you shall not commit adultery, also said, you shall not murder. But if you do not commit adultery, but you do commit murder, you have become a lawbreaker. Speak and act as those who are going to be judged by the law that gives freedom, because judgment without mercy will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful. Mercy trumps over judgment. This far. So what James is saying here is if you look at other people and you make a quick judgment about them, then you are breaking the law. Regardless of what someone looks like or where they come from, they're all God's creation. Now I want to just bring this home to us a little bit here. How many times have you... Let's use Orange Walk as an example. How many times have you gone to Orange Walk and you see someone on the streets there and you make a quick judgment? Maybe it's their hair or lack of hair or their color of hair, or maybe it is their clothing or lack of clothing, and you make a quick judgment of that person. Or maybe they're full of tattoos, or maybe they have piercings and places you don't approve of, and you make a judgment of that person. Now, James is talking about rich versus poor, and we can't use that in our congregation very well. You may think that there is rich people here and there is poor people. There is rich people in our community. We don't have poor people. We have some that are that have more than others, but we don't really have poor people in our community. What James is talking about, rich versus poor, you got to remember that in those times there were slaves and there was masters. So there was a way bigger difference where they came from than where we are today. But we still, nonetheless, we make judgments of people. So now if there would be someone that would come into our congregation, maybe in shorts, maybe in flip-flops, maybe in long hair, a man full of tattoos, and we would look at him and we'd like, what are you doing here? Why are you coming into our church? No, you can stay back there. You don't need to come. You don't need to come into the main sanctuary. James is saying, you are breaking the law by that. And I found that interesting how he ties the law into all of this. See, people at that time, they understood law very well. They were taught law their whole life. They understood what the law was. He says, God does not show favoritism, neither should you. He says, in God's eyes, it doesn't matter what job you have, how much money you have, what kind of a house you have, what kind of clothing you're wearing. He says, in God's eyes, that doesn't matter. He says, I created that human being. They are all created in my image. He says, now who are you to place a judgment on these people? He says, God does not show favoritism. And just to confirm that a little bit more here, I want to bring in a couple of passages out of Romans and one out of Acts. Romans chapter 2, verse 9 through 11 says, there will be trouble and distress for every human being who does evil, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. But glory, honor, and peace for everyone who does good, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. For God does not show favoritism. And then chapter 10, verse 12 says, for there is no difference between Jew or Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him. Let me just read one more passage. This is out of Acts chapter 10, verse 34. Then Peter began to speak. I now realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism. God does not show favoritism. Now, Peter he had been called to Cornelius' house. Cornelius was a Gentile, and the Holy Spirit fell on him. I spoke on that last week a little bit, and he says, now it's clear God does not show favoritism. God will accept all people. Now, if God does not show favoritism, should we show favoritism? Absolutely not. We shouldn't. But have you ever thought about it that we do? Would you be willing to just admit to yourself that you do show favoritism? I do. I had to admit this to myself that I do show favoritism. We're not supposed to. We should be quick to listen and slow to speak and slow to become angry, like chapter 1 says. And the reason why I bring that in is there will be people that think different than we do. There will be people that look different than we do. But we should still be willing to listen to them. We should still be willing to fellowship with them. Now we will, and generally we will fellowship more with people that think like I do. And that is okay. But when we are not willing to serve those that don't think like us, that may have a different viewpoint, if we now say, okay, well, with you I will have nothing to do with, then we are being judgmental. Then we are judging those people. We are still supposed to be willing to serve those people, and we're still supposed to be show the love of Jesus Christ to those people. It's okay if they think different than we do. Now I want to lift out three things here that James is talking about. He says the first one is when we appoint ourselves a judge over people, he says that's wrong. John chapter 7 verse 24 says, stop judging by mere appearances, but instead judge correctly. So when we judge people by outward appearances, he says, that's wrong. You're putting yourself in a position of God. He says, God can look at a person and he can see the inside of a person. God knows how that person is. But if you judge a person simply by the way that person looks, You're placing yourself in the place where God should be, not where you should be. God is the one that will judge these people. We're supposed to hold one another accountable, and we're supposed to, if it's a fellow Christian that you know that wants to walk as Christ, then the Bible does say, judge correctly. Judge by what you know they are doing and saying, by the way they are living, but not by mere appearances. And the second one is, he says, God has chosen the poor of this world to be faithful. God chose the poor of this world to be rich in faith. Now, why would James say that? What does he mean that, by that? See, Jesus says that it is hard for the rich to... It is easier for the camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Why did Jesus say that? Did he say that it's impossible for a rich person to get into heaven? No, that's not what he's saying by that. But why does James say that for the poor are rich in faith? Now, I want to draw our attention a little bit to this thing here, to the rich and the poor here. Very often, the rich people, they will rely on their wealth to get them through things. If I'm sick, I'll just go to a doctor. I have the money. I can pay for it. And I'll find the best doctors there is because I can pay for it. They rely on their wealth to get them through. If I get into trouble with the law, I will just pay a certain amount of money and they will it'll be okay. They will release me again. He says the poor people, they can't rely on their faith. The poor, they rely on Jesus. The poor, they have to rely on God to help them through. When they get sick, they can't as quickly just run off to the doctors because they don't have money. When they get in trouble with the law, they can't just go to the bank and take out a certain amount of money and to buy the law off. They have to rely on God. He says that very often the poor, their faith is stronger than the rich people's faith is. Now, it doesn't say that the rich people can't have faith that is just as strong as the poor person's faith is. But very often, we can learn from a poor man's faith more than from a rich man's faith. And third, James reminds us to follow the royal law. And what is the royal law? The royal law is love your neighbor as yourself. Now, who is your neighbor? Is it just the one that's sitting beside you? Is it just your wife or your husband? Is that your neighbor? Your neighbor is that person that you place judgment on. That person, when you go to Orange Walk and you see them and they come towards your vehicle and you know they're going to be begging for money, that is your neighbor as well. And he says, if you can't love that neighbor as yourself, then you're breaking the law. And lastly, he says, if you do not show mercy to those people, how is God going to show mercy to you? How is God going to be merciful to you? There's three things that James lifts out here. He said in verse 6 and 7, he says, is it not the rich that are exploiting you? Is it not the rich that are dragging you into the courts? Is it not the rich that are blaspheming the noble name of him whom you belong to? And he says, why do you then, when they come into your church, so to speak, why do you tell them that you can come and sit up front here? And to the poor people you say, no, you stay back there. He's reminding them, is it not those that are fighting against you? Verse 8, if you want to just go to the next slide there. If you keep the royal law found in Scripture, I'm not going to read all of that. You can gladly read it for yourself. See, in the days of James, like I said before, they were very familiar with the law, and they said that there were some laws that were more important to them than others. They figured if they kept the Sabbath, then that would give them extra brownie points with God. We see this in the ministry of Jesus. When Jesus healed someone on the Sabbath, that was a big deal to them. They would like to stone him for simply healing someone on the Sabbath day. But there's all these other laws, or some of these other laws, they were okay with if they were bent a little bit, if they were broken a little bit. They were okay with that, but the Sabbath, that one had to be kept. You had to keep that the Sabbath law. And today, it is kind of like that as well, right? If you go to church on Sunday morning, then you're good, and then you're okay. But James wraps all of that up, and he says, if you do not love your neighbor as yourself, you've broken all the laws. You've broken every single, you became become a lawbreaker if you do not love your neighbor as yourself. If you do not love that person that you can't stand, the person that is way down on the, on your list, says if you do not love that person as yourself, you're a lawbreaker. That's tough, isn't it? That's a little bit hard here. Why would he bring that together like that? And see, Jesus said, all the laws come together. All the laws of the Old Testament, he puts them into two laws. He says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and will. And he says, love your neighbor as yourself. Now James says, if you show favoritism, you're breaking that law. You're breaking all the laws. Now think of it this way. How many speeding tickets does it take to break a perfect driving record? Now here in Belize, I know it doesn't work very well. You can get many speeding tickets and it doesn't affect your driving record. But in Canada and the States and many other countries, if you get one speeding ticket, you will notice that next year when you buy insurance, your driving record is no longer perfect. You will pay higher insurance because you've had one speeding ticket. And that is kind of how it works with God's law. If you break one law, you've broken all of them. Now, does that mean that you're going to pay a higher price to get your salvation if you break one law? No, that's not what it's talking about. But he says, as Christians, he's talking to fellow Christians. He says, as Christians, this is for your own good if you love your neighbor as yourself. So what can we learn from this? What can we take away from this here today? What is James wanting us to learn from this? First, he says, you got to realize that every human being is God's creation. He made everyone, not just you, not just myself. He made everyone. And he says all of them are equally valuable in God's eyes. Each one is as valuable as the next person. And some of you may have seen this illustration, may have heard this illustration before, but I want to give that illustration here today. Who wants this $50 bill? Who would like this? Ronald does. Well, there's a few more that do. So you would like this $50 bill, right? You know, this one, it's $50, and you would like it now. Now, if I crumble it up like this, do you still want it? You still want that. And if I throw it on the floor and I step on it, do you still want that? You still want that, right? And the reason is, no matter what you do to this, it keeps its value. It will still be $50. And that is how we are in God's eyes. There's people that have been crumpled up. They have been thrown down. They have been stepped on. They've been pushed into the dirt through whatever reason it is. Maybe it was through addictions, through hurt in their lives. Whatever it is, they're in the dirt. But God says they are still as valuable as they were the day I created them. They are still my children. They are still my creation. And he says, don't you dare treating them as anything less than that. He says, who do you think you are by showing favoritism? And when we let that sink in, I think we all have something to confess of. I think we can all think where we showed favoritism. I think we can all think of a time when the Holy Spirit was nudging you to invite so-and-so over for a meal or to go over and talk to them, but instead you would invite your close friends or someone that was well-to-do, because we want to be seen with people that are of importance. So my challenge to you this week is, talk to someone that you normally wouldn't talk to. Invite them over. Invite someone over that you normally wouldn't invite over. And this goes for all of us. don't show favoritism. You don't know what that person has been through. You don't know why they are where they're at. You don't know why their body may be filled with tattoos, may have long hair, maybe and raggedy clothes. You don't know what kind of pain they have. You don't know why they're doing that. How about getting to know that person and asking, what's going on? How can I be of help to you? Instead of shunning that person. Love your neighbor as yourself. Let's close. Holy God, with the worship team come up already. Holy God, we come before you, and God, we thank you. We thank you that you do not show favoritism to anyone. We thank you that you value each one of us enough to send your Son, Jesus Christ, to die in our place and to be risen from the dead so that we can have life, that each one of us can have life and we can have it to the full. And Father, help us to see where we can be of help. Help us to see where we can further your kingdom. And Father, I pray that we would all be convicted this week, that we would go that extra mile to that person that feels like they are down in the dirt, and that we would reach out to them, and that we would invite them over, and that we would fellowship with them. Holy God, I pray that we would, as brothers and sisters in Christ, as your children, as your followers, that we would live that out, that we would not just be hearing the word and not doing anything with it, but that we would live that out. Father, the price that you paid for us is very big. We can never repay that, and we do not need to repay that. All you ask is that we will be a true reflection of Jesus Christ here on earth. And you sent us your Holy Spirit to help us and to guide us and to walk with us so that we don't need to do it by ourselves. So, Father, may your Spirit fall on all of us. May the power of the Holy Spirit, the anointing of the Holy Spirit, be upon all of us. Lord God, may you be worshipped and praised throughout the week, and may people come to know you because of what we as Christians do. May your Spirit draw those that are down in the pits and those that don't know you. Holy God, we thank you and we praise you in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. We're going to sing it in English, then in Low German, and then in English again.
thank you very much for coming out this morning. May the Lord be with you. May you be encouraged and go and do what you hear, what you've heard from the Word of God. So the Lord bless you. We are dismissed.